Hello, AMP2. So we are going to kick off this semester talking about the endocrine system. Now, AMP1 finished up with the nervous system. That was the whole last section of your class. In fact, there are multiple chapters on the nervous system. The endocrine system comes next in the book because there's actually a lot of similarities between these two systems. So in class, we're going to do a little compare and contrast. But just to get you thinking, right, remember the nervous system. It's trying to control the body. It's very interested in maintaining homeostasis, right? And the way it controls the body through those neurons, long axons reaching out to the body, it is a system that is set up to communicate really quickly, right? So we have these acute, almost instantaneous responses to very specific targets, right? Cells that are being communicated with through those neurotransmitters, right? Reached out and touched by the nervous system. It's really good for those short-term, quick, necessary changes. Now, the endocrine system, when we think about the similarities, this is also a system that is trying to control the body, to maintain homeostasis, but it's going to do this very differently, right? So the big thing in the endocrine system is the way those messages are communicated. This is via hormones, and hormones are just chemical messages that are produced in one part of the body, travel through the bloodstream, and reach out to distant cells to communicate, right? So that is a key definition there, using hormones, traveling through the bloodstream to reach distant targets. Now, when it controls homeostasis, it does this in general, it is much more gradual, long-term changes, and it's much more widespread, right? Not a specific target cell like we saw in the nervous system, but more widespread. The endocrine system tends to talk to a lot of cells at the same time. So then in chapter 18, we are going to start off by thinking about different types of communication that takes place between cells. So this is intercellular communication, and we see five different types here. Now, table 18.1 does a really nice job of summarizing this information. The first thing you should notice is we are talking about intercellular communication, not intracellular communication, right? These are prefixes that you'll see an awful lot if you're going into health-related fields. So this is a good time to make sure we have those straight, right? Inter is referring to between adjacent cells, right? Neighbors. Intracellular means within the cell, right? So this is intercellular communication. How do cells communicate with other cells in the body? So the first one that we see here is direct communication. I don't know if you can see that. So direct communication, what we're talking about here is cells actually having connections between them that allows essentially the free flow of ions and other small substances. One of the places, and this is through, if you think back, I think it was chapter 3, through what are called gap junctions. Do you remember those? Actually, it's like a little pore between these cells. So we will see this when we get to the cardiovascular system. This is super important in how the heart works, right? So if a cell in the heart depolarizes, right? If sodium, say, moves into this cell, that sodium can now flow through a gap junction into the neighboring cell, right? There's this direct line of communication. This is really important in how the heart contracts, how it's able to beat more or less as one, that sodium just flows freely through all these connected cells and they can depolarize in unison. So that is direct communication. Our next form of intercellular communication is called paracrine communication. Now, this ends up sounding very similar to endocrine communication, the topic, the main topic of this chapter. The thing to keep in mind here, I think your key for paracrine communication is that it is extremely localized. It's within the same tissue, and it's basically cells just talking to neighbors right around them. Okay, so paracrine communication takes place through the extracellular fluid, right? These yellow blobs are trying to show some kind of chemical being released and talking to the neighbor. Now that neighboring cell has to have the correct receptor to receive that message. The other thing, the way we talk about these chemical messengers, we give them a slightly different name to distinguish this from endocrine communication. So you'll see them, they're calling them paracrines, or sometimes you'll see it called paracrine factors, or honestly what I think you'll see the most is them just being referred to as factors. So for example, cardiovascular system again, we'll see vascular endothelial growth factor. Right, so different growth factors, you could count, so let's do that, we'll do growth factors. I think another good example of paracrine communication would be histamine, so in the inflammatory response, a chemical is released and that's going to change cells in that general vicinity, right? So those might be some examples for you. Autocrine communication. This is one that students and myself have a little bit harder time wrapping our heads around, right? Because autocrine, auto is meaning self. And so in this picture here, they have chemicals being released and actually docking to receptors on the same cell that received them. This is possible. I think it's a little easier to think about how this works in something like the immune system, which we'll also get to this semester. What we're dealing with here would be maybe the best example, white blood cells, a helper T cell is the white blood cell that's kind of in charge of communicating with the B cells, right? Those are the ones that produce antibodies, and also with cytotoxic T cells, the T cells that go out and destroy. You don't need to know that yet, but notice my little arrows here, right? This is going to be little chemical messages, things like maybe if you've heard of cytokines. Remember that was the big thing in COVID, the cytokine storm, people all of a sudden are releasing way too many of these kind of immune system modulating chemicals. That's what we're dealing with. I think that's the best example probably of autocrine communication. Our fourth type of communication is the main topic of our chapter here. So endocrine communication, this takes place via the bloodstream. That is a key thing to keep in mind. So we're going to use these chemical messengers called hormones. Right? And again, if you didn't get to that definition the first time, a hormone, it's just a chemical. It's produced by a cell or gland in one part of the body. It travels through the bloodstream to a distant location where it has effects on its target cells, right? Again, those target cells need to, just like we've seen in these other ones, need to have the correct receptor to receive that message properly. Okay, so that's a long distance kind of communication. And then last but not least on their list here is synaptic communication, which may be the type of communication that you're most familiar with, because that's what you finished AMP1 talking about in the nervous system, right? So quick reminder here, they're showing the axon terminal. We have these little vesicles filled with something like acetylcholine, could be another neurotransmitter, but acetylcholine is a really common one. That chemical message has to cross the synapse, the gap between the axon terminal and that target cell, right? So it travels across the synapse, the neurotransmitter does, right? And this is an extremely specific way to communicate, right? If you think back even to the muscular system, right? You had a motor unit, right? You have an axon reaching out, and then you get a variety of different axon terminals coming off there, but it's really, you know, it's a handful of cells that are being communicated with, right? Again, that target cell needs to have the appropriate receptor, okay? These are your five types of intercellular communication.